Lelièvre, and also Vincent Delecroix. They're going to tell us about how wind flows through trees.
Thank you, and I want to thank the organizer for this conference and having us give some lectures. I will start with some history of the problem. Because it's a question about wind tree models, so what are they models for? It's models for Lorentz gas, and Lorentz gas goes back to 1905. And what is Lorentz gas? It's actually not a gas of gas particles, it's a gas of electrons in a metal or something. And the electrons are supposed not to interact between them and to interact only with the big guys, which are the atoms, which are laid out more or less regularly. So in this model, you have the atoms which are supposed to be static and the electron which moves and interacts only with the atoms. Okay, so in 1912, of course this is supposed to be three-dimensional and the shapes are more round than square, but Ehrenfest, so Paul and Tatiana Ehrenfest, in a book about statistical mechanics, they present a model with a random placement of the obstacles. So it's a 2D model where the obstacles are rectangles at a 45-degree angle, like this, and the trajectories start horizontally or vertically, and they always stay horizontal or vertical because the bounces are perfect. So this is a sage illustration by Vincent. So he put the obstacles with some random probability at different locations in the plane. And then these are examples of trajectories. So maybe if you could run a few more examples, you could see some more variety of examples of trajectories. So trajectory could come, and so that's some zone of the plane. And sometimes it's going to be a lot more complicated, like do all sorts of tricky moves in some part of the plane, fork it, or if some obstacles are more or less aligned in a square, it will almost cycle for a long time and go away. Okay, so I don't think a whole lot is known about this model with the random placement of obstacles, so any of you who feel bored at some point in the week, that's a good subject to study. And in 1980, two physicists from Orsay called Jean Hardy, and so it's not the Hardy from Hardy Little, and Jean Weber, said, okay, let's rotate the picture by 45 degrees and put the obstacles on a grid. So the obstacles are Z2 periodic. They are rectangles of dimensions A and B. And then they kept in line with the former idea of studying the 45 degree trajectories. So also they restricted their study to the case of dimensions A plus B equal to 1. Which means that the diagonal lines go through these and these corners. Okay, so here are some examples of trajectories. And then a few years ago, some people from the flat surface community decided to start studying this model. And the interesting thing about the periodicity is that if you look at the fundamental domain, you can project to something which happens in a compact space. And since in recent years a lot has been discovered about this setup, then what can we extract to say something meaningful about this problem? So that's the idea. So the different questions one could ask. Did we have any more pictures planned?
Sure.
I don't. Okay, so that's a view from further away of trajectories. Mm-hmm. And I think there is a view from even further away. So
wow.
Yeah, those are the same trajectories as before, but seen from more of a distance.
What's the color?
Sorry?
What's the color there?
So there are three trajectories, one red, one blue, and one green. Mm-hmm. And the small obstacles are the purple dots, purple squares, actually. So, and this is for dimensions A equals B equals 1/2. So the obstacles fill up a quarter of the plane.
So, yes. Is this picture why you care about rectangles? Is it something you can observe that looks like that in physics? Is that why you want to have rectangle obstacle?
I think rectangles are there to make life easier. So, but people also study the periodic setup with round obstacles. It's two very different worlds. In the round obstacles, when you have some parallel beam going into an obstacle, it goes out divergent. So it's a dispersive billiard. Whereas this, everything stays the same width and travel more or less together. So what can happen is that some part goes this way and some part goes this way, but when there's a corner. But it's not as dissipative as the round case. So it's two different worlds. Were there more? That's it for now? Okay, so the questions. So given a trajectory, a billiard trajectory in the what we call the wind tree. It's a billiard table which is infinite. It's the plane with some rectangles removed, laid out as we saw. We can ask if it comes back near its starting point. Maximum distance up to time t, and what's the rate in terms of t? Is it something like a power of t or less? So it can't be more than t, because if it goes straight out and there are no obstacles, it just goes at rate 1, which is t2. And does the trajectory visit the whole table? What can we say about almost every trajectory? So does almost every trajectory come back near the starting point? Do almost all trajectories have the same rate of excursions? Do almost all trajectories visit the whole table? And we can also ask more questions.
Are we always looking at pi over 4 trajectories? Or
sorry?
Are we always looking at pi over 4? Or are we looking
No. So we fix A and B. And given a trajectory defined by some x and theta, so no, we don't restrict the angle, we don't restrict the dimensions of A and B, so A plus B can be 1 or anything, and the angle can be anything. So that's called these directions. So
And then, of course, we can ask these questions with fixed theta or with, for almost every theta. So there's a whole gradation of things you can vary or keep fixed. Okay, so now I want to move to a much simpler problem, a billiard problem, which is the billiard in the square. And present some techniques that are useful there and see what we can do with these techniques in this setup. So, consider a unit square and linear trajectory at angle theta. So what happens is that the trajectory bounces off the sides and it gets reflected, and there's some group that's hidden there. It's so the directions of the trajectories are in the image of the initial direction under the reflections along the horizontal and vertical axis. So in four directions. And the trick is to consider a different version of the square for each of these directions. So, and then to glue them back together. So, we use a square like this for the trajectories going this way. And then a pink square for those which were going this way, but now we reflect it so that they also go this way. And a yellow square for trajectory is going in the reverse direction, but we rotate it by pi so that now they also go this way. So we can trace back the initial trajectory like this, and then there's a green which should go here, but we can also put it here. And the portion of trajectory goes there. So now this is called the unfolding. If you have a paper napkin in the restaurant, you can play this game. You draw this linear trajectory, but then you unfold the napkin, and you've got four copies which represent the four directions. And then this whole side is glued to this side, because when yellow bounces off a vertical side, it becomes green. And this side is glued to this side. So we get a torus. And the billiard flow on the square becomes the geodesic flow on the torus. Now, if we fix a direction, we have a restriction. So it makes sense to fix theta, because the questions about filling up the whole space, if you start with a given angle, your point is never going to visit the portion of the phase space which is near another angle different from this four somewhere else. So the phase space morally for the bigger flow is the square across the directions, but there are some invariant layers which correspond to the quadruples of directions like this. And in here it's the same. You never change direction when you flow in a geodesic flow. So we call this the linear flow on so torus, let's call it T in direction. And one thing we can do is to uh, So we have a choice of fixing the torus or fixing the direction. So instead of, so let's call this flow phi t theta. So it's the thing that pushes everyone by an amount of t in length at unit speed interaction theta. So instead of phi t theta on t, we can consider phi t vertical on a rotated copy of t. So e to the I. So it's probably not theta. It's your head so that the trajectories are vertical going upwards. So. This is the flow. Okay. So now something we can do to study this is to introduce a section. The original square, we could take as a section the union of two sides of the square, so view that as a segment with an angle, and then this part of the segment is set to this part of the segment, and this part here of the segment is mapped to this vertical side. It's if you unbend this, it means that you have some segment which is cut up into two parts which come back in a different order on the bottom. So it seems that they have changed length, but actually the length is not measured correctly here, because it should be the length with respect to this direction, so you should project to the orthogonal of the direction theta. So I'm going to draw it here now. The good thing to do is to start from this corner and go up to this length. So this is the interval I to consider. And now the way it's cut up is like this. You project the two corners of the square to this segment. So the bit that is outside the square is actually inside the neighboring square, so it's somewhere here. It's just to this line. And now we see that the yellow line is here and the green line here, and they got exchanged by the first return map. So under phi t, I sweeps the whole torus, and the first return map I to I is an interval exchange transformation, so a 2i t. So this means interval exchange transformation on two intervals. And we can note that if we vary the angle, we get all the possible ratios of lengths of the two intervals. So maybe we should keep the names.
bearing theta of ratios. So now let's go back to our wind tree model. And take into account the Z2 periodicity. So I think we have some pictures.
Not for the one.
Not? Okay. So So I assume that my obstacles are centered at integer points in Z2. And that they all have dimensions A times B. So there are two ways to pick up a fundamental domain. Well, there are many, but two are nicer. One is to cut at halfway between the obstacles, like this, and so this is a square, as you can see from my drawing, and there's a rectangular just one rectangular obstacle in the middle. So since the picture is tied by such thing, we should think of this side as identified to this one, and this one to this one, and now we have, instead of a billiard inside the square like we had before, we have a billiard on a torus outside of the square, okay? But we can do the same trick, which is that trajectories will be reflected, and in my current code, I think this was the pink one. And so this is coming back just here. This is here, it goes like this. Now it's white again. I shouldn't think it's recurrently, so this goes somewhere. And at some point it's going to hit maybe here and become yellow. So I should use four copies of that. And that's what we have a picture of, maybe. So it's the other picture. So another way to pick the fundamental domain is in an L shape. Like this. Okay? And now, when you go through these parts of the sides, you go to the next copy. And when you hit here, you change copy. So you have four copies of an L. And there are some greens. And so, going from the billiard in the original wind tree to the fundamental domain is like this. So you see that when you hit the part which corresponds to the obstacle, you get reflected, and when you hit the other parts, you just continue straight through as in a torus. So this is continuing opposite. Now it's hitting the side, so it should reflect, which it did. And now it should go to the other side and keep going. Here it's part of the next square, so it bounces off. And when it gets here, it continues. It goes up here, then it reflects. So you see that there are... this one had more vertical obstacles, but mine is with obstacles more like this. So this part and this part, this part and this part, you have reflection. The other parts, you go through. And stay in the same copy. So when you use the four copies, you will have a picture of the four copies in the next slide. Mm. And so the four copies should be reflected from this one, but the thing is that the reflected L's you can always rearrange because it's a part of a torus. So because this is glued here, I could always put it off and draw it like this. So I would have an L facing the other way.
So that's what I do to my other L's. I rearrange them to look like an L. Okay, so that's the four L's. That's the original L. That's the reflected copy, which should be a mirror along the vertical axis, but we shifted this place, this small part, to be here. This one is reflected along the vertical axis, but the bottom part here is moved up, and this one we've done both. Okay, so can we have a trajectory? So this is the trajectory from before, and when it bounces off, it in fact changes copy. When it doesn't bounce, but goes through, it stays in the same copy. And what happened there? We did put about the corner.
Yes, almost.
So it got reflected and stayed in this copy.
So you missed that.
No. It went up.
Yes, it's in the green. It's in the bounce right now.
Okay, so it went just below.
Mm-hmm.
It's above, it should stay in the same copy. It bounces, so it goes there.
Yeah, it's obscured by the red dot.
So it's inside the width of the red dot. So there's a small part which wanted to reflect, so it got to this other copy and did a bit of traveling inside the red dot. And then, because this part is not bouncing, it stays in this green copy, and it travels from just up in the red dot up to there. Now it wants to bounce, so it changes copy, it goes blue, and it goes up here, and so on. And that's the rest of the trajectory. So again, we gained that the trajectory only travels in one direction, and the surface in which it travels, it's a bit more complex than four copies of a square making one torus. Now it's four copies of a torus with obstacle, which make a more complicated surface. Maybe we have a picture for that. We don't. Okay. So, maybe that's a good enough picture. There are several pieces which are glued. Instead of having the four squares or just one square with the gluings, now you have four L's with some gluings. Some are within the same L, some are to the next L. Okay? And this surface has the same property as the torus, that there's a well-defined direction, and so when you travel in direction theta, you always stay in direction theta.
What's the genus?
Sorry? What's the genus of this surface? Okay, so the genus is 5, and there are 4 special points. So the nice thing in the torus was when you did the gluing, the corner which seemed special in the square billiard stopped being special in the torus, because it was just like any other point. What happens here is that the same happens when you have these squares of the original torus. The same happens nowhere. So now what happens is that all the special points come from the 3 pi over 2 corner here. And in the square torus, you got 4 of them, 4 times pi over 2, which made a normal angle. Now you've got 4 times 3 pi over 2 at each of these 4 special points. You have 6 pi around. So when you can check on these gears with the identification that when you want to go around this point, this is glued up there. So that's 3 pi over 2 plus already pi over 2, that's 5 pi over 2. You've done over 2 pi and you're still not back at the start. And when you keep going, this is glued up there, that's another pi over 2. Then you go to this one, here, 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 and same here. You got back. So that's 6 pi. Okay. And since the points all have different symbols, it's an easy exercise to check that they all have 6 pi. Okay. So the flow is undefined when it reaches these points, but that's a measure 0 set which have the forward image or backward image hitting one of these points. So no big deal. And since the surface has this fourfold symmetry, we can see that it projects to a surface which would have only one of these L's. And so if we draw all these different colored lines on the same L, that would be also a translation flow on another surface, which this surface projects to. Just use one of the L's. So let me draw this. So let me use this L now. This. Okay, so it's supposed to be a square with a missing. Okay. It's supposed to be all the same, sorry. More or less. And instead of drawing the line on different copies, I just draw it all on the same copy. That's a perfectly valid translation surface with the gluings. This is glued here. This here is glued to this here. This part is glued here. And this part is glued here. So this surface we call MAB. So A and B are two lengths. And this surface we call LAB. Okay. So similarly to the linear flow in the torus, where I considered some section, here we can also consider a section. And in LAB, we could take as a section the union of these four N-shaped lines. But we have to, so, and we are flowing in direction theta. So differently, you should count the length really according to a transversal to the direction. So there's a cosine theta and a sine theta for the rescaling. So we get an interval exchange on eight intervals. So this one is cut up into 1, 2, 3, 4, and all of them are cut into 4 intervals. So let's call this A. That's the copy 00, 10, 01, 11. So A 00. One returns to the end of the interval 1, 0. So it comes at the end of this one, like this. So I'm not sure exactly what's the length.
No, it's just a single.
Sorry? Oh yes, this is this goes here. So A00 stays in the copy 00.
It's not at the end.
And it's not completely at the end. What comes at the end is C. So A00. Now B00 goes to the next copy, and it goes in the first part. So B00 lands here. C00 comes at the beginning of at the end, complete end of the 10 copy. So C00 comes here. And D00 goes to the second part of the of this one. Okay, and likewise, A01 stays in the same copy and goes as a third interval here. B01 moves to the copy on the right, which is B1 on the copy 11, and it comes in the first position. And so on. So this would be C01 who returned here, and D01 returned here. And who's here? In the first place, it must be B. So that's B10, which came from the second position here. And that's B11, which was here in the second position. And A11 goes to the third position, A11. A10 goes here, same position, A10. C11 goes to the last position below, C10, and conversely, C10 goes last up here, C11, and D11 stays in 11 in the second position now, and D10. Okay? So, sorry. So our interval exchange transform, so we have a 16 IET, 16 interval exchange transformation. So an interval exchange transformation is cutting up a union of intervals into subintervals, rearranging them, and they keep the same length. So to describe it, we need a permutation. So here the permutation is exactly described by this. So it's that A00, B00, C00, B00, A11. I should use the same indices as up there. A00, B00, C00, B00 is rearranged. That's actually the permutation type. Not try to copy because I would make more mistakes. So. And the lambdas are so you have lengths for the intervals, lambda A, lambda B, lambda C, lambda D. So all the A's have the same length and so on. And if you use the correct normalization, so which means you would project to a line orthogonal to a direction theta. So lambda A is 1 minus A
cosine theta. Please correct me. Sine theta, maybe. D cosine theta. A sine theta. And 1 minus B cosine theta. So remember, this whole length is 1 here. This length is A, so this is cut up into length. 1 minus A, A, and this is A, is B, and this is 1 minus B. Then you need to take into account the angle. And when you project to the LAB, this big mess becomes a lot simpler because you can just remove all the indices of the ABCDs and you get just one interval exchange on the 4IET. So section of the linear flow on LAB in direction theta is a 4IET with pi is ABCD goes to the order BDAC. And the same numbers. Okay. Good. So, what we can notice, like in the case of toroid, is that if we vary the angle and the dimensions A and B, we can get all possible interval exchanges on four intervals with this permutation. We can't get to another permutation, of course, but so vary A, B, and theta, get all ratios of lengths like that in so it's four positive lengths, but so projectively you get the one. So all possible ratios of lambda A, B, C. It's actually bijective, so if you can express one in terms of the other. Okay, so another remark is on the Hardy and Weber setting. So A plus B is 1, and theta is 45 degrees. Then what you get is that A and B have the same length, and so do C and D. So in other words, when you have your interval exchange on, and so you remember the permutation is A, B, C, D goes to D. A, C. So these two have the same length. These two have the same length. So if you take the first return map to the PC portion, so this means that you have your interval on that A. Back as lambda B, lambda A, lambda B, lambda C. So what I mean by first return to BC is that you want to induce on this subinterval,
And now lambda b goes here to lambda a, but after one time it comes back here.
I think you're d and a.
D and a are mixed up. Otherwise it would be really interesting. So, sorry, I should have two lengths, small length, long length. And here I have small, long, small, long. So lambda b goes to lambda b, which is the same as the old lambda a. So after that, it goes at the end, the interval, the right interval. So that's lambda b and lambda b. So in used map, exchange on two intervals like we had for the chorus. And the one thing I didn't say, but maybe all of you noticed, is that when we have a map of interval which is an exchange of two intervals, if we glue the two ends of the circle of the segment to make a circle, it's just a rotation. IET is almost the same as the translation by lambda z torus. It's a one-dimensional torus or a rotation on the circle. So depending if you view it as a one-dimensional torus, you might want to call that a translation. If you want to see it as a circle, it's more of a rotation. Okay, so that's one more reason to be really interested in the dynamics of what happens on the torus. And the time is almost up. I have 10 minutes. Okay? So...
Wait, you should probably try to finish a little sooner than that.
Yes, for questions. Okay. And the last remark is that if A and B is a half, then the L is made of three equal squares, so that also projects to the torus by a different way. And we have many reasons to study the problems on the torus. So the good thing about tori is that they are far, so let's call the, let's take the unit area tori. They are parameterized by SL2R modulo SL2Z. So the first, the two columns of a matrix of determinant one give you the basis for a two-dimensional torus, and SL2Z is changing basis. So that's it. And now we want to. So when we rotate our torus, it's the same as acting by rotations on this. And so there is a link, strong link between the dynamics of linear flows on tori and the dynamics of SL2R acting on SL2R on SL2Z. We will see that in the problem session. But it's also true when you go to more complicated translation surfaces. We saw a translation surface of genus 5 recently. And if we know something about the action of SL2R, especially the orbit of that surface or the orbit closure under the action of SL2R on some space of translation surfaces, it tells us stuff about the linear flows on that surface. Okay, so now I want to try to answer some of the questions from the beginning, and for that I need some vocabulary. So, trajectory of
the wind tree billiard is recurrent if the limit of the distance from x is 5 t theta x is 0. So it comes back near itself and nearer, and we say it's divergent otherwise. The diffusion rate is the exponent of t in the distance from x to phi t theta of x, so it's the limit of distance from x to phi t theta x over t.
What is phi t?
But sorry?
What is phi t?
So trajectory is the action of the linear flow of, or the billiard flow phi in direction theta in time t. And so you take log and log to see what exponent of t you have in the degree and how far it's gone. And we say that the system is transitive if there exists an orbit going everywhere, dense orbit, and we say it's ergodic if it can't be split up into two parts, two invariant parts of a non-zero measure. This applies to the billiard, not a single trajectory. Well, also a single trajectory. So a trajectory is transitive if it's dense, and the billiard is transitive if there is a dense orbit. And ergodicity means that there exists no partition of the billiard table. So TAD is the wind tree with parameters AD. Into two parts where the measures of A is non-zero and the measure of B is non-zero. And which are invariant. For some special parameters AB, so which parameters are those for which 1 over 1 minus A is x plus y squared root b, and 1 over 1 minus b is x plus 1 minus y squared root b. Some rational x and y and integer d. So that's some algebraic condition on the parameters. And then the Hausdorff dimension of
the set of thetas such that the diffusion rate is different from 2/3. So 2/3 is the usual thing, and there is a positive Hausdorff dimension set which have different than 2/3, and the Hausdorff dimension of the set of thetas for which phi t theta is not recurrent. That is all trajectories for every x, ptx is not recurrent, is more than a half. So these results are by a variety of authors. So this is by Avila and Hubert. So actually, this is the almost every AB attribution.
All AB.
This is Delecroix, Hubert, and Lelièvre for almost every AB. This is Franchek. Also, and the contribution allowing to go from almost every AB to every AB is taken. And these results are by Vincent. Advertising, and we're happy to share the worksheets if you want to play with them. That's it.
Do you have any questions for Samuel?
Is there an intuitive reason why the diffusion rate is 2/3?
So yeah, when I asked the questions, I forgot to say what should we expect. So the physicists were saying if it behaves like a random walk, like because when you hit the obstacles, you might go in one of several ways. So random walks have 1/3 for the diffusion rate.
One half.
And when the diffusion rate is not 1/2, sometimes the physicists call it abnormal. So here the 2/3 comes out of the part that I didn't describe, which is the study of the dynamics of SL2R acting on moduli spaces of translation surfaces, the Lyapunov exponents there, and so it's not intuitive. I mean, unless that's all very natural to you, but it's to the man in the street, it's not intuitive why you should have this exponent almost always.
Are there more questions? Fran?
Yeah, so I understand the infinite billiard, but where's the infinite surface?
Okay, so I didn't plot it on the board, but you can do the same as for the square or the billiard on the torus with an obstacle. Here you have the whole plane with some obstacles.
Mm-hmm.
And the angles between all the boundaries are always multiples of pi over 2.
Mm-hmm.
So if you start in one direction, you will always use 4 directions.
Okay.
So you could use 4 copies of the plane with obstacles. And then you glue them the right way. That's an exercise to figure out the gluings in the 4 copies of the plane tied by this array of obstacles. How should you glue the sides of all these rectangles between the 4 copies to produce the surface?
Yes. Okay. And so, for example, recurrence for theta implies recurrence in this surface. Right?
Yes. So, the billiard with the 4 angles is the same as the surface with just 1 angle.
Okay.
because every point in the initial billiard with one of the four directions corresponds to exactly one point in the surface above, where there is only one direction. Yes. So what you say about the billiard table or about the surface,
it's
the same.
Okay, so I think, why don't we postpone more questions for the coffee break, which is later. So why don't we have our next talk starting at, say, 3:35, because we're running a little late, so, yeah.